complex task to improve school climate, culture, community, and connectedness. Building on prior successful groundwork in social responsibility and from a strong historical foundation, the school felt it was time to address issues related to some tough realities and community perceptions. This is their story.
I was only in the school for about a month and a half when our cross-boundary process was initiated. I was absolutely aghast when I found out that 145 students that year, 145 students of the incoming grade eights had put in for a cross-boundary out of our catchment.
When I got here at Centennial, it was at a real big transition time for the school, specifically in the administration. Basically anything that the administrative team had sort of worked to establish with the students in any form of connection or a relationship was being severed.
Yeah, I walked into bathrooms and I would get things thrown at me, or paper towel, or kids would, I wouldn't consider it a bullying tactic, but it was just more so the way the school was.
The school felt like it needed something. I know that the administration had been in transition for a period of time, and also that they had laid a really nice foundation for social responsibility. I felt it absolutely necessary to continue on in that work, and there were a few indicators to me in my first few months that made me believe that that was the direction the school should go in.
They saw kids doing things that weren't great, and I think maybe unfairly so, that it tarnished the reputation of Centennial.
One of my colleagues actually incidentally indicated to me after a few months I'd been there that Centennial had a culture of violence, and I was initially offended by that, but having worked here now 7 years, I can look back on that time and actually realize that, even though I didn't want to hear it, perhaps she was right.
And there was fights all the time, and we just kind of did it for sport almost, right? And it was, I'm not sure if you can categorize that as being a grade 9 boy or being an idiot.
The staff were very quickly able to come to me and communicate with me around the perceived reputation of Centennial in the community. And although we still had some very high academic standing, the reputation of our students in and around the community was significant and not in a positive way.
As what proved to be one of the most crucial aspects of its work, Centennial began a partnership with Dr. Shelley Emil's team at UBC. Dr. Emil provided the school staff with some SEL professional development over 2 years, but perhaps most importantly, designed, implemented, and analyzed a school climate and connectedness survey that served as baseline data for the work ahead.
So what we were looking at was students' perceptions of what the social climate was of the school. Do they feel they belong? Do they feel accepted? Do they feel supported by their teachers? And in particular, we looked at whether they felt that they were victimized by peers, whether they engaged in bullying, whether they witnessed bullying. And we also added questions about how students engaged in social responsibility activities, getting involved in community and school projects that make the world a better place. And that was the focus. And the wonderful thing about Centennial is usually it takes about 3 to 5 years to change the culture of a school. So when we went in there in 2008, the idea was to find out what the experiences were. And based on those experiences, the school engaged in quite a number of different activities to make things better, make the social experiences better for the students. And then happily, they basically asked us back in 2012 to evaluate whether things had changed. And after 4 years, we'd expect some changes.
An SEL task force at the school analyzed the findings of the survey, and from there, several initiatives were put into motion. They focused on 3 aspects of school connectedness: caring relationships, professional learning, and school leadership. As one of the first major initiatives to promote caring relationships, Centennial worked with the Dare to Care organization and used the partnership as an impetus for change.
Well, Dare to Care is a bully prevention and life skills program, and I'm the life skills part. It started back in 1998 with a lady by the name of Lisa Dixon Wells, and it was a K-9 bully proofing a school program, but nothing for the high schools. With my experience as a policeman in the school program, the school resource officer, I saw great students making bad choices, not aware of the consequences. And my worst days as a policeman is when I would charge somebody and they'd look at me, "Constable Peace, I didn't know that. If I'd known that, I wouldn't have done it." So I developed sessions to educate them so they could not say they didn't know. It's like, "Nope, you did know, you just chose not to listen." And so that's what I have been doing ever since 1998. And some of the things that I want the students to get is that everybody has a story. And then if you take the time to get to know another person's story, you have more compassion, understanding, respect for them. The problem is we just don't take the time. And so what I do is I come in and I do an assembly, which gives them all the same base knowledge, and then we do small group sessions. So it's kind of like a keynote session and then workshops. And the workshops is where we really get a lot of the work done with students. We talk about empathy, but the small group session, you experience it. You experience empathy, and it's in real form. And I think that it's important that we understand what it's like to walk in another person's shoes.
Furthermore, several intentional community-related and adult-student meeting structures were emphasized and cultivated.
We have weekly meetings with certain staff members to talk about students who might not have that connection and sort of working towards them.
And what we try to do is create a sense of community among those kids and make them feel really comfortable that this is a home away from home, that we're a fairly large school, but within that, we don't have to feel disconnected.
If you walk around the school at lunchtime here at Centennial, now for most, lunchtime is about 85 minutes, you will see many open doors. You will see teachers in their classroom on their lunch block or on their prep block, and you will see kids in those classrooms. I don't know if I've ever seen a school with that number of teachers and that number of kids in classrooms, but there are many, many safe places and many, many good places for kids to go.
Professional learning continued over the years on the importance of SEL, character education, restorative action, and quality teaching.
With regards to professional development, the staff embarked on a journey that focused on character education, focused on the importance of social-emotional learning, focused on particular techniques to support social-emotional learning in the classroom.
Social-emotional learning is kind of a new fad, and I don't want to think about it as a fad, but it's a new focus in education. And I think the reason it's a focus is because the idea of educating the heart and not just the mind is not a new one. It goes back to Aristotle. But a lot of times that's considered fluff, especially at the secondary level. Things that, you know, we're really focusing on curriculum. Finally, we have research showing that if you don't deal with the social, you're not going to get the academic. So there's a lot of research that's been coming out in the last few years that's showing that schools that do address the social-emotional aspects of learning or of kids' interpersonal relationships are actually showing improvements not only in the social atmosphere of the school, reductions in bullying and things like that, but they're also showing higher academic performance. So we finally have the evidence to do it. And Centennial was a school that embraced this, and as I said, many times at the secondary level, that's not as easy to do. So we did come in and we did a few workshops with the teachers and sort of explained to them why this was important. And I think it's a school that really picked it up.
I have 95% control of what happens in my class. And then of course the school, you know, culture and vibe, all that stuff, it gets affected. But in a sense, I get to create what I, you know, the atmosphere that I want.
Teachers were open to it. Certainly we also polled the teachers about whether they felt supported by the staff in terms of promoting this, whether they felt that they had enough training, and that also improved over the course of the 4 years.
I wouldn't call us a restorative action school or a school which involves restitution, but that was certainly one of the approaches that we utilized in dealing with discipline.
The staff, outstanding, especially after going through the small group sessions. I had a number of staff members say, you know, it really made me realize that when I come to this school, I need to check my ego into the door, that I'm actually here for the kids, not for myself. And I had other staff members say, what I realize now after going through the small group session is that in some cases, it's a miracle these kids attend school, let alone function.
Finally, strong, consistent school and student leadership provided ongoing pressure and support to make things different. Several school-wide structures were developed to identify and support at-risk students and plan interventions, all through the lens of student connections.
As principal, having been here now 7 years, there's been a consistency of message and a consistency in approach. Whether it's our transitions program, which started out as an attachment class, whether it's our at-risk learner intervention meetings, whether it's our summit meetings to support at-risk youth, whether it's our ESL LEC block, which supports some of our newly arrived Canadians and gives them a place and a home. Those are things that we have identified as crucial to our journey and things that we have found highly effective. And in keeping and maintaining the same leadership in a building for a period of time, I think has contributed to a very successful set of initiatives.
The EAL LEC class is one of the busiest rooms you will ever see. It is filled with students of all language levels, but mostly at the beginner-ish level. And they're working on everything. They're working on English, social studies, physics, planning, all of their courses. We have some very talented peer tutors in there that help as well. And students are in there because they need extra time, they need extra help. Mrs. Panwar is in there with, and she knows what everybody's doing, even though it looks like chaos, it's very, very effective chaos. The kids bring their lunches in. There's a lot of work gets done, but it's also a safe place for kids to hang out, have their lunch, maybe make some new friends.
I wanted students to sort of do something more socially responsible, more community-minded, and have the opportunities to do that, because at that time there wasn't that avenue.
Sometimes the question is asked about how we really do form connections between students who've come from such diverse backgrounds, from various countries, and some are new, some have been here for an extended period of time. And really, I have to be very honest, a lot of it comes down to money. I would like to take 80 kids up Indian Arm, or I would like to take 85 kids on a Carol ship cruise, or the same number out to a pumpkin farm. And a lot of money goes into creating opportunities for students to have those experiences, and those are the experiences that they probably cherish and remember more than what happens in the classroom. The other money part of what makes this machine work is that we are staffed so appropriately. We have enough staff to do the right job in and outside of the classroom, and when other teachers have come to observe and hopefully replicate what we have, if they don't have administrative support, then they simply cannot do it.
In 2012, Centennial chose to conduct another student survey to determine whether or not their work made a difference. The results were impressive.
Well, we did find that in 2012 compared to 2008, students reported that they felt safer. They felt that teachers and peers were more caring in their behavior towards them. They were more respectful and more helpful when the kids needed help. So that was compared to the kids in 2008. We also found that kids were less worried and less concerned that they would be hurt, so the fear had gone down. In terms of social bullying, which is kind of the more subtle form of bullying, and the kind of bullying that kids deal with on a regular basis, sort of humiliation, rumor spreading, that gossip, those kind of things, they certainly reported significantly less witnessing of it. So the kids were seeing changes in the climate of the school in terms of that. Kids were reporting that things were getting better and they felt that they belonged more. They felt more accepted within the schools.
In addition, over the years, there have been other indications of improvement. Since 2008, the number of cross-boundary transfers out of Centennial's catchment to go to other schools has decreased, while the gap between outgoing and incoming students has narrowed significantly. Also, the number of student suspensions have seen a steady decline over the years, and the number of Level 2 and Level 3 suspensions, reserved for the most violent and problematic behaviors, is almost negligible.
When we ask kids who they hung around with more, did they hang around with people from their own cultural groups, etc., there was a tendency, not significant, for those kids to feel the most distant or removed or not welcomed. But what we saw was that dropped significantly by the time they got to 2012. Fewer kids were hanging around in their isolated cultural groups. There was much more mixing and kids having peer groups of different cultures. So in that regard, that although it wasn't significant, it was moving in the right direction, that kids were feeling more that it was a multicultural school where everybody was respected and appreciated.
While we are proud of our accomplishments over the last few years, this type of work is never complete. new students must be acculturated and staff must continue its focus on professional development, caring relationships, and leadership. All good things must be nurtured and maintained.
In retrospect, it's easy to look back and actually see that much of the work that you did made sense. At the time, in the moment, I think you're just experimenting and trying a few things to make the situation better. But really, we focused on three aspects. We focused on leadership, we focused on caring relationships, and we focused on professional development. And we involved outside experts in our journey to see if they could guide us in along the way.
The students, the teachers, the administration, and just the school itself kind of changed the way that Centennial was perceived from the ground up, though, right? It was done from the classroom, done from the way people were treated, and it was done from the way kids treated each other as well.
I feel that in this school there's a lot of acceptance for kids from all cultures, and I feel like students care for each other. And I don't know how we do what we do, but it's a feeling. And students will tell you that sometimes when they walk in this room, after they've already been at U of T for a few years, they walk in at all the art on the walls and they feel like they're coming home.